We arrive at the Sweet 16 in the NCAA Men's Soccer Championships. Tonight, the Kentucky Wildcats, the number 9 seed at historic Briggs Field to take on the number 8 seed, Clemson Tigers. Here's how we have arrived at this point. The Tigers on the bottom advancing with a win against Denver last weekend. Kentucky protecting its home field with a 2-0 victory on Santa Clara. A little bit later on this evening, a number 1 seed Oregon State against a number 16 New Hampshire team that upset North Carolina in the previous round. And hi, friends, and welcome in with Kevin Kennedy, Pete Yannity with you. Well, things are always tight in postseason play. Virtually every kick might mean something. We expect that kind of match here this evening.
Yeah, looking at the defensive records of both of these teams, this game just feels like it could be 1-0, moment of individual brilliance, or possibly a set piece.
And speak to that point of the two goalkeepers this evening. St. John's transfer Jan Hoffelner has had quite a season for the Kentucky Wildcats, best in the nation in terms of goals against.
Yeah, Pete, we're talking about a Kentucky team that's only conceded 9 goals on the year. Very good defensively.
George Marks recently received ACC honors for the Clemson Tigers. He, too, is having another fine season.
Yeah, and George, for me, the shot stopping, communication, all that is brilliant, but also very good with his distribution.
It'll be the second all-time meeting for the Wildcats and the Tigers. When they first got together, it was in the 2001 NCAAs. The Tigers won 1-0 in overtime in that match. We come back and start it out after this.
Got long hair goals?
Fala pessoal, boa noite para todo mundo, boa noite aí para a família do Luca. Começando agora a transmissão, tirei aqui por causa dos intervalos rapidinho, só para explicar um pouco. A gente está falando no formato dos Estados Unidos nas oitavas de final, que eles chamam de Sweet 16. Quem ganhar essa rodada passa para as quartas, que é o Elite 8, que eles chamam, depois semifinal e final. Então, só para situar, esse jogo é das oitavas de final, na casa da Clemson, que foi melhor ranqueada. A Clemson hoje, ela está com um recorde de... 14 vitórias e 5 derrotas. E a Kentucky está com um recorde melhor ainda, de 15 vitórias, 1 derrota e 4 empates. Então, temporada muito boa da Kentucky. Os comentaristas estavam até mostrando que a defesa da Kentucky, que o Luca faz parte do sistema defensivo, é atualmente a melhor defesa do país, com menos gols sofridos. Então... vai ser um jogo duro, porque Clemson também tem uma defesa muito forte, mostrou o goleiro da Clemson, mas é um jogo aberto nesse ponto. Um gol pode fazer a diferença, porque a equipe que marcar primeiro vai conseguir fechar a casinha lá atrás muito bem. Kentucky na rodada passada passou ganhando de 2-0, 2 bolas paradas, 2 gols de escanteio, o primeiro do próprio Luca, o brasileiro, filho do Marcos, da Simone, que estão por aqui, e depois o atacante, acho que foi o número 9, um lourinho, fez o segundo gol de cabeça no escanteio também. Então, estava até conversando com o Luca no WhatsApp. Bola parada, eles treinaram muito essa semana, então pode ser que apareça algum gol por assim. O jogo já vai começar em 5 minutos, eles estão terminando aqui a propaganda, e aí qualquer coisa a gente vai entrando para comentar. Também mandar um alô aí, acho que deve ter gente que não está nem entendendo, porque o Luca mandou para os outros internacionais. Então ontem, a pitch do Rodrigo, classificou também, então Pete já está nas quartas de final, muito bom, Rodrigo voltou, jogou jogo passado, o jogo foi na mesma hora da Libertadores, aí não fazia nem sentido a gente transmitir, mas a Pete acontecendo coisas relevantes, quando o comentarista fala algo, eu venho aqui para a gente ficar conversando. Hoje eu estou aqui porque vinha gente de site de aposta, ficava mandando um monte de spam, então se você quiser comentar, a família aqui, mandar uma mensagem para a gente botar na tela, lembra de se inscrever no canal aqui embaixo e também curtir a transmissão, igual eu tô fazendo aqui com a mensagem do Luiz Felipe. Então, sempre que alguém for comentando, eu vou soltando aqui na tela, mas para comentar tem que estar inscrito no canal. É isso, vou sair aqui pra gente pegar a transmissão toda e já já eu volto. Valeu, galera.
And you're invited. And right now, get a free Microsoft Surface Laptop Go with your purchase of $16.99 or more.
The Kentucky Wildcats, they use a somewhat unique 4-4-2 in addition to their fine goalkeeper and others. Two important players for them would be down near the bottom. Eitor Bjørgelsen, he is a player that's really come along, native of Norway, and they spread their scoring around as Kentucky. So not necessarily one guy, but of late, Bjørgelsen has been really good for them.
Yes, absolutely.
And for the Clemson Tigers, of course, a Tiger team using their 4-3-3. They come in seeking a 15th win on the season. Leading goal scorer on the year has been Isaiah Reed, the junior out of Rock Hill. And he is someone the Tigers...
Curiosidade, só que pode ter gente falando de fora, Cats é o mascote de Kentucky, são os Wildcats. E a Clemson são os Clemson Tigers. Então a gente vai ter uma batalha felina hoje, mas torcendo para Kentucky ganhar.
Former Dartmouth assistant, where he actually went against Mike Noonan when the Clemson coach was the head coach at Brown. Well, Settergren has done a really nice job with the Kentucky program, seeking a 118th win tonight in better than a decade of work. And Mike Noonan, of course, Clemson fans now familiar with a coach who has guided this team for a dozen seasons and done such great things, and the Tigers in a 34th NCAA tourney. And, of course, he has been on hand for several of those trips.
Oh, Pete, late November NCAA tournament soccer doesn't get much better than this.
Mike Noonan visiting with him on Saturday, just ecstatic at this time of the year. And as you can say the same for Johan Cedergren as well, to be in the Sweet 16. Of course, the Tigers have made many trips to the Elite Eight, Kentucky trying to get to an Elite Eight for the second time, and hoping that on the road they've got the ability to overtake Oscar Ogren and the Clemson Tigers. There's a guy who knows this facility well, Mason Visconti. We'll talk more about him in a moment. Defender for Kentucky underway here at historic Riggs Field. And we expect to see a very aggressive Kentucky team. Tigers will try to counter that aggression. Pipe Fernandez getting it ahead. It'll be a sprint. What a nice job sliding it back to his goalkeeper by Luis Grasso.
Again, ball's just a little bit heavy for Isaiah Reed to get onto the end of, but not a bad idea by Fernandez Salvador.
Tigers coming in having played really well offensively once again this year. Historically good a couple of seasons ago, as you'll remember. The Tiger team on the season, 45 goals so far, and here tonight playing in their 20th match.
Eu ia comentar justamente disso, da torcida, estão fazendo barulho ali com o tambor. E lembrando também, o Rafael, goleiro do nosso programa, enfim, já está negociando propostas. É legal ver porque Kentucky hoje é a melhor defesa, então o goleiro faz parte disso, e o goleiro da Clemson é cotado para draft, então é interessante por isso. E um comentário que eu queria fazer, a grama está meio amarelada ali, principalmente no meio de campo, porque lembrando que a gente está entrando em dezembro, então já está frio, ontem nevou no jogo da Pitt, só que as faculdades que jogam mais para o norte normalmente têm campo sintético justamente para esses períodos de inverno mais rigoroso. Então, ontem nevou no jogo da Pitt, eles jogaram com neve, mas a gramada era sintético. Esse gramado é original, e quando começa a ficar 5 graus, 0 graus, menos 5 graus, a grama meio que queima, fica amarelada. Mas o gramado continua tapete, só que um pouco mais amarelado. O que está acontecendo agora aí, escanteio para Clemson.
E for Kentucky. Goes out once again. Kentucky Wildcats, one of just two schools in the SEC that play soccer, South Carolina the other. So those two schools actually belong to Conference USA, although with the current tumult of the conference landscape, for the Wildcats at least, that could be changing sooner than later. They're weighing some different options. But for now, they're locked in on postseason play. After coming through and winning a Conference USA championship, Their coach thinks they can make a deep run. Nice job stepping up by Hoffelner.
And as you know, Pete, that Conference USA is home to the defending national champion Marshall and a number of very good programs. We saw Florida International here earlier in the year. Familiar with UNC Charlotte.
Hoffelner kicking it away.
That's a miscue by Diop there.
Diop unable to convert for Clemson. Johnson for the Tigers. Kentucky tends to attack to the box and really toward the middle. That's at least what Mike Noonan was telling me Saturday, Kevin.
Well, with that 4-4-2 formation, Pete, they're going to play with two central forwards. One of those looking for Aitor Beyer-Golfson is more of a target player. He can pin the ball up, get other players involved. Here's a good look here. Have players coming underneath him.
You saw Beyer-Golfson. Out in front, they'll feed it. That was Meinzer. Lefty shot attempt. They were trying to set up Maurice in front of the net, but the entry pass a little bit too wide.
I see screen here just shaping that ball inside, looking to get a little misdirection. Just a little heavy on the pass.
Robert Screen back in the Carolinas. The player just attempted that pass from Raleigh at a Wakefield High. Marks runs up for the Tigers. Diop. Screen. Strong kick ahead. Maurice was chasing it, but well beyond. George Marks, 7 shutouts this season. Probably comes in here feeling like he'll need to get an eighth if the Tigers are to advance, based on how good Kentucky is defensively. Just 9 goals allowed, as we've noted, by the Wildcats this year. The Tigers, some early action. Looked like it was Reed on the attack.
And Luca Rodriguez is just able to snuff that out. And both of these goalkeepers, very good. George Marks, second team All-Conference in the ACC. And then Hoffelner was Goalkeeper of the Year in Conference USA.
Fed toward Maurice. Amadi Diop got in the way of it.
Yeah, Peter really thought the offsides flag was going to come up in that situation. Looked a hair offsides.
There's the former Tiger, Mason Visconti. Shot Maurice, but a good recovery by the Wildcats to continue. Maurice, right foot to the center. Able to work away.
Yeah, really nice by Alvaro Gomez.
That time the feed ahead to Fernandez Salvador, but unable to execute.
You can see it's a good yard offside there, just beyond. Just getting a little word for kicking the ball away at the last minute.
Kentucky's third Sweet 16 trip in the past 4 seasons. Good footwork by Enzo Maurice. Visconti to Beyer-Golfson. Centered. Beyer-Golfson. feeding back to his teammate. The shot is wide. Pretty good opportunity there for the Wildcats, but Bailey Rouse unable to convert.
Yeah, it looks like that took a slight deflection.
Primeira oportunidade mais clara da Kentucky, vindo da ponta esquerda, puxando para o meio, e acho que ele até abriu demais, mas parece que teve um desvio. Enfim, a Kentucky, ia falar justamente disso, ela costuma atacar muito pelas pontas, então a gente vai ver muito isso, a bola abrindo nas pontas e depois fechando para o meio para a finalização. E agora o escanteio, bola parada muito forte também.
Kick for the Wildcats. Diop, among others, positioning in front of his goalkeeper. Strong kick. And the Tigers able to come through with a stop. Clemson going 5-3-0 in the ACC this season. Take another look at the corner kick.
Yeah, just shaping it into the back post. A lot of chaos in there for the goalkeeper to deal with.
Wildcats are as good as they are defensively, 36 goals scored this year. Tigers on the season, 45 goals scored.
Oh, B. Roll is so good. Able to hold that ball up with Hominy Diop on his back.
Recovery, boy. Pepe Fernandez getting spun. And that was a painful moment for the Tiger senior from Ecuador.
Yeah, it looked like perhaps just a dead leg there right in the... That's exactly what it was.
Visconti, who was here back in 2018, so you would suppose they know each other. We noted the goals scored, and you see these teams on the top 13 in goal differential, and we say that because the slightest tally on some nice footwork, but it'll be given away. Centering pass.
Well, we talked about those individual moments of brilliance, and for me, Pete, that's one of the players that is capable of conjuring something up is Usman Silla. So dangerous in and around the area.
Diop. Silla.
You get a glimpse there of his creativity and his vision.
But you look at the goal, the fact that each team has been very good in terms of goal differential now related to tonight, and just being one better is probably going to decide things.
Well, I think that speaks volumes to...
Fala, Leonardo. Até o Marcos comentou aqui embaixo, não tinha visto ainda. Mas no jogo de hoje, o único brasileiro das duas equipes é o Luca, o zagueiro da Kentucky, número 3. Então, botando aqui a resposta na tela para quem não entende português, vai pelo menos ver. Mas o brasileiro que tem no jogo é realmente o Luca. E lembrando também, galera, de curtir a transmissão aqui embaixo e se inscrever no canal para poder comentar. A gente já está aí com 161 pessoas, deve ter muita gente da Europa também, mas só para a gente dar uma moral e aparecer para mais gente, para aparecer o Luca, até para mais gente do mundo inteiro. Então lembra de curtir aqui embaixo, que estão com 15, 16 curtidas. E aí a gente vai seguindo a partida. Chegando agora, 33 minutos, lembrando que a contagem ela é regressiva, então a gente tem aí 12 minutos jogados, faltando 33 a jogar.
Matter whoever wins this match will be able to watch in real time. Alan Johnson did the activity that time for Clemson.
It's going to be a Kentucky corner there. Last touch from Charlie Asensio.
Asensio simply would be the first to tell you he whiffed on the attempt to knock the ball down.
And we'll see what Kentucky does here. Then everyone have a number of different set pieces. On the first one, they converged on the goalkeeper and came off the line in swinging service.
Wildcats 105 corner kicks on the season coming in. In their previous 20 matches, this is their second of the evening. Rodriguez initially for the Wildcats. Visconti, the crossing pass. Silla. And the infraction on the Wildcats, Nick Gutman.
Yeah, Silla, so much to deal with there. Gutman did his job, though. Delay the counterattack.
Sprinting over and delivering the kick, Hoffelner. And the whistle, I think everyone in the building, other than Bailey Rouse, recognized that we were going to get the whistle.
And you can see Luke Andrews here coming just a little bit from behind. Shoulder to shoulder is fine, Pete, but that shoulder goes into the just slightly the shoulder blade there. Easy call.
Shot attempt. Oh, what a goal!
Is that the grad transfer, Callum Johnson?
Callum Johnson. Third goal of the season.
Couldn't tell, Pete. Looked like that took a slight deflection. Maybe threw off Hoffner to the last second.
Just the seventh goal allowed this season in his 18th match for Jan Hoffelner.
Nicely done from Sila there to find him. Oh, I think it did take a deflection. Ironically, looks like it came off of the foot of this.
É, 1-0 Clemson. A gente estava comentando que Kentucky estava tendo as principais chances, até numa bola despretensiosa ali na ponta direita, só que teve o desvio do zagueiro. Então, o Luca estava marcando o lado esquerdo de ataque deles, eles atacaram pelo lado oposto. Com o desvio ali, matou o goleirão, porque, de novo, foi um chute ali da ponta, aquele chute que o goleiro consegue fechar a diagonal tranquilo, mas o desvio matou ele. Mas, de novo, galera, ainda faltam 30 minutos do primeiro tempo e 45 do segundo. Tá muito ainda no início da partida. Vamos ver como que vai desenvolver tudo e torcer pela virada de Kentucky, mas 1-0 Clemson no momento.
As we note, any moment in these games, and you could probably say about any game, but it just seems as if every time a foot touches a ball, especially obviously near the box, it could be an impactful moment. That might be the difference when we're done after regulation play as to why the Tiger team advances.
Yeah, what I think is also always interesting too, Pete, is this ryegrass is starting to take root. They throw down on top of the Bermuda here in late November. It has a tendency to get very slick with some condensation. So also just a missed tackle, a slip and fall right there in the area. Anything can happen.
Tigers on the attack. Asensio getting it ahead. Silla.
Well, Clemson starting to have a little bit of success, finding their holding midfielders, building out of the back. It's always dangerous when you play with a 4-4-2. You have two midfielders matched up with that midfield triangle.
Justin Malou actually touched the ball on the previous play.
Yeah, a little handsy from Agron there. Well, as big of a body as B.R. Golson is, dealing with Luke Andrews is no small feat either.
Their two forwards, Jurgelson, 6'2", 195. His coach describes him as a handful. And the other 5'10", 175, Luke Andrews. It was he who committed the foul just before the first goal of the match by Callum Johnson. Malou for Mike Noonan, one of the many recruits he's gotten from the nation of Senegal, getting ready for the throw-in. Mike Noonan, ninth NCAA trip during his tenure with the Tigers.
And nicely defended from Luis Grosso there, Kentucky center back. Oof. That's a good idea from Fernandez Salvador, just looking to play behind that Kentucky back line.
Get the impression that Usman Silla had something in mind.
Yeah, terrific tackle from Meinzer there. That's the last thing you want, is for a player of Usman Silla's to break that midfield block and run at that back line.
That's Rodriguez. Gets it across to his teammate, Luis Grosso.
Danger.
Hard contact that time. Play moves on. Isaiah Reed looked like he had a breakaway opportunity.
Yeah, I like the idea with the one-touch pass from Fernandez Salvador, but Hoffner so good at judging the ball and playing off of his line, able to snuff that out.
Jorgelson got in the way of that. Marks. Able to line up that attempt by Enzo.
Jogada muito importante do Luca é essa. Se ele não dá o combate ali, deixa passar, iam subir dois de Clemson. Então, jogadaça do Luca nessa.
The game is, we have some end-to-end soccer before, a little cagey, feeling each other out. But both teams are certainly getting forward.
Wildcats take about 14 shots per game. Again, they score enough, but their brand is more about defense, having allowed no more than one goal in their previous five matches, and just in two of those matches, double overtime win for their league championship against Florida Atlantic. They won 2-1.
Good discipline defensively there for Clemson. Move your feet, keep your eye on the ball. Don't lunge in for a tackle.
Hoffelner, their goalkeeper, of his 12 shutouts, three have come in the past five matches for UK. Wildcats 2-0 against ACC teams on the season prior to tonight. Screen. Knocked down nicely by Diop. Opportunity in front. Strong kick. And just a little bit wide. And that time, Luke Andrews had a San Jose, California, St. Mary's transfer.
Now you can see he spun. He found himself free. Lovely turn there. Great first touch to free himself. And he didn't miss by much, Pete.
Team leader coming in. 35 shots attempted on the year for Andrews. Visconti defended by Johnson. Fernandez.
Good decision by the referee. There was the initial foul. Pipe rode the challenge.
Mason Visconti, we told you, played for the Tigers a few seasons ago, and his coach at Kentucky, Johan Cedergren, really has enjoyed having him in his program.
Yeah, he talked a lot about his growth as a player, because when Visconti was on this Clemson roster, Pete, he was an attacking player. He's a wide player, and now he's being deployed as a outside back, and a lot of those skills can translate to get forward. He says he's been pleased with his growth.
They recruited him out of high school in Kansas City, and when he decided to make a change, Wildcats are more than happy to reopen the relationship. Fernandez, nice feed. Soa. And Reed. Oh, what a nice job on the save by Hoffhelder. Really quick reaction.
Yeah, Malou just picks him out.
Or Malou, rather.
He picks him out at the near post. Just end-to-end action. We've seen both forwards very good turns to free themselves for a shot.
Reed a quick turn, and Hoffhelder an equally quick reaction.
Maurice just looking for Visconti to get forward there.
Fernandez was setting up to try to receive that pass. Wildcats do a nice job in the back. Wilkerson with the header. And firing through Visconti. Miscommunication. Fernandez. And right in front of the student section for the added energy.
Well, Pete, we talked about the crowd when we opened the broadcast, but I think they're still continuing to file in here.
Visconti getting ready to throw it in.
Looks like we could be getting our first batch of subs here from this deep Kentucky team here.
Screen defended by Johnson. Marcel Meinzer. Visconti. Yeah, deflected nicely.
Substitutions for Kentucky. Entering the match, number 15, Brock Lindell.
This is Visconti.
And number 7, Daniel Evans. Leaving the match, number 9.
See the substitutions.
And number 19.
As they pretty much flip out Brock Lindell and Daniel Evans, they really do try to rotate them in and give them a pretty good amount of playing time for Aitor Bjorgelsen and Luke Andrews.
Oh, this is a player in Daniel Evans coming out off the bench, who is third team All-Conference USA this year with 5 goals on the year.
Yeah. Among their team leaders with 5 goals, Bjorgelsen and Andrews have also scored 5 this year.
Well, that was one thing that Johan spoke of yesterday when we met with him. Pete, he talked, really felt like the depth of this team was a strength for him this year.
Charlie Asensio looking to throw it in for Clemson.
Boa pergunta, Léo. Clemson tem 2 títulos nacionais e Kentucky não tem nenhum. Então, respondida a sua dúvida. E o Celo comentou aqui, espero jogar pela Kentucky em 2022. Aí só explicando um pouco mais, provavelmente você não entende muito do processo, mas se você fosse para Kentucky em 2022, você já deveria ter começado, tá negociando com eles agora. Então, entende melhor o processo para vislumbrar ali 2023, 2024. Porque 2022, a janela já está batendo aí. A gente já está entrando em 2022 daqui a alguns meses.
And this is the risky run when you defend so much, Pete. Not only is it mentally exhausting, it's physically exhausting. Clemson really needs to get a good spell of possession here. They can open up, get expansive, get a little rest.
Having subbed out two forwards for their two backups, do you sense that Johan Cedergren may be looking to adjust off of his 4-4-2 at all and some of what they do with that?
Now they will continue to press the two Clemson center backs. A lot of horizontal movement, try to confuse them, but also fresh legs to press and give you some runs in behind. I think that's a good substitution for Kentucky.
Tigers striking at the 13:43 mark of this opening half of play. Usman Silla, Oscar Agren, and after the foul, those two able to set up Callum Johnson.
Yeah, Callum Johnson just first touch preparation there, second touch quality finish.
Giving the Tigers the 1-0 advantage. Johnson coming down from another ACC school, Boston College. Finished out his career at Clemson.
A sub that Coach Noonan made there. Strobeck coming in for Isaiah Reed is another tactical adjustment there. Strobeck is much more of a back-to-goal type forward, whereas Isaiah Reed is a player you want to play in behind. Clemson hasn't had a lot of success playing in behind that back line.
And a foul against the Tigers. On the offside.
CP just offsides there. Good positioning by the assistant referee.
So the infraction against Clemson. Kentucky, some early activity in front of the net attacking George Marks, but for the most part, Tigers have been able to deny all that many attempts by the Wildcats as our first half has forged on.
Danger now.
Crossing pass, but there to step in front of it was Maurice.
Yeah, just the wrong decision from Callum Johnson there. Strobeck was making a nice diagonal run in behind.
Rodriguez, back to Grassau, now Mainzer. Suddenly the Wildcats a bit methodical. Visconti, he's become a target of the student section, one of their former fellow Clemson students, and Marks is right there.
Essa eu tenho até que parar aqui. Manda um abraço pro coach Rafa Simões, assistant coach da Nova. Jogou nos Estados Unidos, então o cara sabe muito de esporte universitário e é um coach, tá analisando aqui com uma outra visão. E ó, ataque de Kentucky, tirou demais ali. Segunda bola que eles tiram demais, teve a bola ali na esquerda e agora na direita. Então no mínimo três chances claras Kentucky já teve, tá faltando guardar essas chances. Abraço, Rafa.
Take it from the turnover.
Malou's touch was just heavy there.
And was that Diop? He pretty much just flipped out of the way.
He stabbed for it, lunged for it. I'll tell you, Daniel Evans didn't miss by much there.
Mark's kick off the attempted header by Fernanda Sencio. And it'll go out. Saw the official on the sideline wearing what looks to be a similar jersey to Kentucky as Callum Johnson, who scored the lone goal. Will the officials on the field had to change into the yellow jerseys you've seen them wearing because that gentleman there, the others were wearing a similar blazer. And it would blend in too much with Kentucky, they determined before the game. So you see, they've gone
perto
just...
mesmo. Mandar um abraço também pro Vitor, que mandou aí um dinheirinho pro iFood. Tava até sentindo falta dessas doações. Abraço, Vitor. Valeu. Espero que todo mundo que tenha curtindo aí a transmissão. Lembrar também, galera, de clicar no like aqui embaixo. Se inscrever no canal para poder comentar. Também tá bloqueado por isso. Porque, de novo, esse jogo da Clemson... nem na ESPN aberta tá passando, tem que ter o provider, a gente teve que fazer um monte de coisa aqui nos bastidores e Kentucky chegando de novo. Acho que esse jogo tende a ter algum empate em algum momento. Lembrando também que na trajetória do ano passado da Marshall, eles bateram com Clemson, começaram perdendo de 1-0 também, empataram 1-1 com gol de falta e o jogo foi para os pênaltis e a Marshall passou nos pênaltis. Então a história está... se repetindo, faltando o empate de Kentucky. Mas lembrando que a Marshall também jogou contra Clemson e também começou perdendo contra Clemson no ano passado.
Be a nuisance to Daniel Evans of Kentucky, but let's see.
The referee has issued a caution to Clemson's number 5, Hamadi Diop.
So Hamadi Diop issued the caution.
He's gone back to the allowed advantage play on back there. Gone back, issued a card.
So let's show you what led to that yellow card just moments ago.
Yeah, just lunged in, got caught stabbing in. Good decision by the referee to allow the game to play on.
And on the shot attempt by Evans, it looked like there was contact on Diop, and that might have been a little bit of revenge.
Yeah. I think we're going to get a warning here for kicking the ball away.
Our officiating crew, the referee Matthew Thompson, Robert Dale, and Justin Howard rounding out those. And you see our officials with the fourth being Raymond Thomas.
Clemson holding well out of the outside of their area here. It's a good initial win by Oscar Agron.
Return fire by Evans, too strong, and obviously nowhere near the look he had just earlier when he kicked it wide to the right. Mike Newton among the top 10 winningest coaches, and he has seen his teams have to defend that kind of attack many times over the years. Elton Shifamba and
You see Alvaro Gomez getting a breather.
Foul called against the Wildcats.
Nice move.
Handball there, he's allowing play on. Oh my.
Wow.
That's certainly a foul there, but and that looked like that could have been a handball, didn't it?
Initially. And then the Kentucky player who was steamrolled is Luis Grasso.
And Grasso possibly. Clemson was looking for a handball. He was just inside his own area. Nonetheless, kind of a silly foul to commit there.
Tim Strobeck getting no word with the official. And pretty aggressive play by the native of Sweden, Strobeck.
Yeah, just kind of clatters into the back of Grasso.
Grasso from Germany, one of the many European players on this Kentucky team. So things have gotten certainly more physical. What a nice job off the chest, then the header. And Marks able to get out there just in time. Evans looked like he had set his teammate up in great shape.
Yeah, really nice running behind there from Grinning. But as we said, look at the little touch here to put him in behind.
Brock Lindau just a little bit off timing. And now another Tiger hitting the deck.
I tell you, Pete, this game has taken a turn to the physical here the last 5 minutes.
May need to put some pads on. And remember, Marcel Meinzer saw his teammate, Luis Grasso, get run over moments ago, and Meinzer was near the action that time, and now it's Grasso getting a word or two from the official.
We've seen the one card for Hamidi Diop.
Number 8 for Kentucky is Meinzer.
And that foul is nearly identical to Diop's, but as you referenced, I think it was perhaps the second foul for Diop. That's what put him in the book. It's really Grasso's first involvement.
Tigers would love to play with some pace of their own this evening. Last touch by Screen of Kentucky to go out of bounds.
Unfortunately, he looked clear. Just ricocheted right off of his own leg.
Strong, Guzman Silla unable to catch up with it, or rather, Justin Malou.
That's a good idea from Chifamba to change the point of attack. Ball just skipped on the grass. Tell you the momentum of this game that swung back and forth, Pete. You felt like Kentucky had really had a good handle on the game, and all of a sudden Clemson's come to life here.
Box opportunity, but Tigers were unable to get the setting pass. And Casper Grenning, a young player, freshman from Denmark, has really come along this Kentucky program. Able to recover just in time before anything could be set up for Fernandez. Corner kick, though, for the Tigers. Each team with two corner attempts so far. Header, crossbar, and save. Wow.
Was that Oscar Agron on the initial header? Hoffner just got his hand up, put it off the crossbar.
Agron for the Tigers scored the winner against Denver. Talking before the match, Kevin, you are of the impression he could be a very impactful player in this match this evening.
Yeah, for me, watching this Clemson team, he organizes the back line, and he's just such a forceful character for Mike Noonan's team here.
Agron And he'll get it back to his goalkeeper.
Always so composed on the ball. And
coming up on 6 minutes to go in the opening half. Tigers scored just under 14 minutes in on Callum Johnson's goal. Clemson team that over its past five matches has only allowed two goals. One each to Louisville and North Carolina. A nice recovery in the back for Kentucky.
And Fernando Salvador looking to go forward.
Look at frustration. Pass a little bit too strong. But Kentucky the foul. So let's see if indeed Agron was the one with the initial header.
Perhaps Quinn McNeil had it.
Might have been Quinn McNeil. Here's.
I actually hit it off the crossbar. I thought. Yep. Initially thought Hoffner got a hand to it.
It caught all bar and his hand was right below, but he did react well.
Well, and Quinn McNeil for me is a player that's really come into his own this last year. Four goals on the year, four assists. He's had a couple of game winners. Third team all ACC. Well, you can see what a handful Scylla is back there for Clemson. If I'm Coach Noonan, I'm trying to get the ball on his foot in and around the area all night long.
And is. And it'll go the other way on the offside. A little bit too strong for Hernandez. Hoffelner getting ready to run into another goal kick. And once again, it'll go back to the goalkeeper for the Wildcats near midfield. Agron, gonna hang time on that. Fernandez getting back to his teammate. Tigers looking to reset. Diop. I'm not sure that was necessarily the plan.
Yeah, I think he was trying to link up with Brandon Parrish. Still, Brandon Parrish was on the move. Nonetheless, the pass was too heavy.
Hoffelner originally from Germany. Headed out by Fernandez. That's David Parrish, Kentucky. It's actually taken more shots than the Tigers so far, 5-3, but Clemson made the one that counts.
Yeah, I think that's a natural in a game like this, Pete. The one team's got the early goal.
Brining with a chance for a header. The Wildcats bench, one of the foul called. Beautiful set. I think he was setting up Daniel Evans. And you see, that is one angry head coach, Johan Cedergren.
He's looking for something there. Looked like there was contact, but I don't think that was a foul. I don't think that warrants a penalty in that situation. We'll have another look.
No, actually, it might have been Lindau they were trying to keep with the pass.
Yeah, I think actually.
Or, no, maybe Rouse. Yeah, Rouse was the intended target, and simply a matter of getting positioning. Let's take another look at what happened in the box.
You can see the back post run. Looks like Asensio. Looks like the foul is actually on Asensio. Good decision by the referee. It's no penalty there.
Bailey Rouse is trying to score. Here's Clay Holstad for the Wildcats. Thought it was interesting their head coach, Jan Cedergren, describing his team as like herding cats, and he didn't mean it as a pun, their nickname being a Wildcat. But he just says at times his guys just get a little bit out of control, and, you know, he's got to kind of rein them back in.
And well, they've certainly brought the energy tonight, Pete. I think they've been very good. Clemson got the somewhat early goal. I think it's natural to see the opposing team really throw a lot of bodies forward, take some chances. And Kentucky's been dangerous in those moments.
Lucas Rodriguez and the Wildcats trying for a 16th win of the season. George Marks, good so far for the Tigers.
They're just going to run the clock down here and just pump this one forward. Clemson win the initial header, call to half.
Final 10 seconds before the intermission.
I'm actually shocked that that's got to be a book in the neck. He should have gotten the first one there.
There we go.
Shouldering the guy's back, and that's simply frustration.
A lot of frustration as Brandon Parrish of the Tigers pops to his feet. Clock frozen, 1 second remaining. Take another look.
This is a foul here. That's the first one coming through Strobeck's back. Ball gets squirted free. It's just rolled over there.
Yeah.
Takes out Brennan Parrish.
Looked like Grasso was maybe going for the tackle, but just a little bit too aggressive. So here is an opportunity for Hamidi Diop.
4 seconds on the clock here. Clock will start when Diop makes contact on this set piece.
Diop, one of the Tigers from Senegal, but came through the academy in Florida that so many Tigers move.
É, galera, faltando 1 segundo aí, sempre que tá essa enrolação para essa falta, porque ele vai bater e vai acabar. É, e teve o lance ali de suposto pênalti. Ah, eles botaram mais segundos ali, mas enfim. Suposto pênalti para Kentucky, que na minha opinião era para ter sido marcado. Mas é isso, fim de primeiro tempo, 1-0, jogo totalmente aberto. Se Kentucky faz um gol, leva para o overtime. É, vamos deixar rodando aí melhores momentos, porque a transmissão da ACC é muito boa, ele vai trazer melhores momentos, estatísticas, e a gente vai comentando. Lembrar também para quem está aqui e é brasileiro, está entendendo o que eu estou falando, clica aqui no like aqui embaixo para ajudar a gente, ajudar o canal, aparecer para mais gente. Apareceu o Luca para mais gente, galera, família do Luca aí que está acompanhando. Daqui a pouco a gente volta, lembrando que no intervalo eu vou deixar no mudo só para não ter problema com os direitos das propagandas, beleza?
Historic Briggs Field. The final Sunday in November has the Clemson Tigers up 1-0 at the half against the Kentucky Wildcats. Sweet 16 action in the NCAA tourney with Kevin Kennedy, Pete Hannity back with you. A first half that Clemson striking first about 14 minutes in on the Callum Johnson goal. About 10 minutes after that, it just seemed like the volume was turned up in terms of physical play.
Yeah, and I think the goal really opened the game up. It was a lot more open than I thought it was going to be. I thought it would be a very cagey affair, a lot of defending sitting back. But that goal really opened the game up, and we got a lot of attacking.
You know, in other NCAA postseason events, particularly in terms of basketball, in the men's tournament in basketball, it seems it gets more physical. In the soccer tournament over the years, I've noticed that there was a little bit more bumping, and maybe the officials let the guys play a little bit more to a certain extent.
Yeah, I think that's a fair assessment, Pete. And I think Kentucky was perhaps the last 10, 15 minutes there frustrated they couldn't break Clemson down. Timely halftime for Kentucky, I think. Organize, get your heads, collect your wits about you.
Take a look at the numbers from the opening half of play. And Kevin, to your point, what jumps out at me, the fouls, and it seemed those happened in a segment of time in the opening half, kind of all consolidated together.
And you can see Clemson got the goal early, and Kentucky really pressed them. There was a period of about 15 or 20 minutes. I thought Kentucky was far better in those moments, but Clemson was able to get possession and get in rhythm again.
And then of their eight fouls, a good number of them probably came in the final 10 or 15. Thanksgiving weekend of the Clemson students made it a point to get out here to the match, and we come back with more after this.
Os comentaristas estavam falando sobre o primeiro tempo, falando até nos minutos finais Kentucky estava chegando mais firme nas faltas, só que nos números gerais Kentucky teve mais finalizações do que Clemson, 5 para Kentucky, 3 para Clemson, mas Clemson foi mais efetiva marcando um desses gols. E legal de comentar que o comentarista que estava aqui na direita da tela, ele é head coach da South Georgia, que é uma faculdade da divisão também. Então é um coach comentando com a visão de um coach que já foi eliminado dos Nationals da D1. Então é isso, deixar rodando aqui as propagandas, propaganda da pizza aí dando vontade para quem ainda não jantou, mas enfim, já a gente volta para falar mais do jogo mesmo.
Teams began in the NCAA Men's Soccer Championship. This weekend saw just 16 still standing. The Clemson Tigers and Kentucky Wildcats playing to get to the Elite Eight. We welcome you back to Historic Briggs Field with Kevin Kennedy, Pete Hannity with you. A physical match unfolding here. This weekend, most of the action was on Saturday. This is one of the few games going on Sunday. But I'll tell you what, if you wanted to wait for an intense match, it was worth the wait of what we've seen in the first half. As for the other matches, a few of the things I would think that jump out at you, there was an all-ACC battle, Wake Forest, Notre Dame, and Duke unable to knock off a 10th seed St. Louis.
Aí, galera, só pra gente comentar sobre seguintes jogos dos playoffs. Então, Pitt passou com o brasileiro, ganhou de 4-0. Notre Dame passou também, Georgetown passou muito forte. West Virginia tem um assistente coach brasileiro, Gabriel Cabral, não tem jogador brasileiro. St. Louis também chega muito forte. E a única partida que está acontecendo agora também é New Hampshire contra Oregon State. E New Hampshire tem brasileiro também, o Bernardo Piva. Então, se passar, pode ser que na fase que vem a gente tenha um confronto de brasileiros. Tem o Kentucky com o Luca e New Hampshire com o Bernardo. Vamos torcer aí para os dois conseguirem passar.
They're upset.
Yeah, wouldn't that be ironic too for Coach Noonan? That's where he got his head coaching start at New Hampshire before he moved on to Brown.
So you would have the connection for the Tigers head coach Mike Noonan with a potential next round opponent, but Clemson with plenty of business to take care of still over our second half of action. A 9 versus 8 seed match should be a tight battle, and we've seen it so far as halftime continues here at Clemson.
Baby got back.
Trying to get back to the Elite Eight and add to the lore in that regard and program.
If you remain steadfast defensively, but if you can get forward and nick one, go for it.
Now, just 10 goals now allowed by Kentucky this year, and only about a half dozen by their starting goalkeeper. Let's show you some of the examples of the physical play we noticed in the opening half.
Yeah, this is Diop here, just late on the challenge there. It's really a second foul, so I think that was simply accumulation. See Grosso getting hit there.
And that time, the yellow card applied to Luis Grosso, the defenseman for the Kentucky team.
Yeah, just a foul on Parrish there. He was late on the challenge as well.
And so the Tigers, they strike after a foul on Kentucky, but that was early in the match, less than 15 minutes in, off the restart. Well, Clemson getting a great opportunity for Callum Johnson.
Yeah, and that's the moment where Usman Silla is able to get free and run at that back four. He draws a lot of attention. Feeds Johnson wide. Johnson's fortunate, gets a deflection on the finish.
A case there
where you're so focused on the likes of Silla and Reed that someone like Johnson has to be ready to strike, and he did for another goal in the season.
Yeah, and then we have Quinn McNeil getting up and heading one off the crossbar.
Callum Johnson able to come through with his third goal of the year. George Marks so far, five shots against him. And the Clemson goalkeeper has seen several of those sail wide, but good work in a match that he's going up against a really fine goalkeeper on the other side. Well, Marks right up there among wins among Clemson goalkeepers all time.
Yeah, just continuing to climb into those record books there. Losing a third on the all-time wins list.
Meanwhile, on the other end, Jan Hoffelner, the goalkeeper for Kentucky, in his first season with the Wildcats after transferring from St. John's, hopes to have a clean second half of action, keep things where they are, and hope that his team can find a way to score the Cats on to what would be just a second appearance in the Elite Eight all time. We noted that he's not been scored on much this year. Coming in, had allowed just six goals in 17 matches.
And it's so tough, and I think he had that shot covered, but it took a deflection, looked like off of Visconti's foot there, and just kind of threw him off. So tough to deal with for goalkeeper.
Clemson students providing some great atmosphere in the match this evening, and no doubt we'll be hearing from them in the background as the second half is underway. Tigers hoping to move on if now play continues. Sprinting after Bjorgelsen. Looked a little hairy for a second, as far as the Tigers are concerned. Oof. Stepping in front of it. Nice job to get the opportunity. Gutman centering the pass. But there was Agren, and Agren stepping up.
And that's one of the things he does so well, Pete. Just anticipated that entry pass. Able to step in front of the Kentucky player and nick that out.
Fernandez. Trying to flip it ahead to Reed. Hoffelner near midfield. Nice center. And a set by Andrews. A shot and denied by Marks.
Nicely taken by Maurice there. Good position from George Marks. Look at Andrews just release Maurice.
Marks getting up there.
And not trying to hold that, just trying to hold that, just putting his hands up, taking the step.
Across the way on that Kentucky sideline, you may be able to notice it. The gentleman standing right in the middle is the head coach, Johan Cedergren. But a lot of frustration over the final 20 minutes or so of the opening half expressed by him and his assistant coaches and some of their players around him.
Well, I think some of that may have stemmed from that incident that they were appealing for a penalty. It didn't appear to be a foul. I think the referee made the right decision there. Looked like actually Asensio was the one that was fouled, but they were hot for a couple of minutes over that.
And unable to run it down, Asensio.
Asensio just played that behind him a little bit, changing the point of attack, but was a bit heavy with this pass.
Rouse getting it ahead. And it'll go back to Marks for the Tigers. Tigers trying for a 57th all-time win in the NCAA tournament.
Oh, that's a good ball in from Asensio. Nice job for Kentucky to break pressure there.
Screen. Oh, he whiffed. Fernandez. And screen. And play will continue.
Yeah, Robert Screen made amends there, didn't he?
Yeah, in a hurry.
Now they say hustle makes up for many mistakes. So fair play to Screen.
Screen.
Had a good year, second team all conference.
Yep. Raleigh, North Carolina native, played at Wakefield High. Tigers on the attack again. A little too strong though on the feet ahead toward Reed. Let's see how quickly he made amends. Did Screen. He had just whiffed on the pass attempt.
Yeah, came in and pressured Fernandez Salvador.
And you almost had to hear a whistle there. As Meinzer hit the deck, but he's the one showing some frustration. Nine fouls against Kentucky. Let's take a look at what just happened.
Yeah, I'm not sure what he's appealing for there. I mean, it's certainly a foul, but I wouldn't say it's a yellow card offense. It's not accumulation.
Diop with a nice job in the box. Jorgelson, and back out it goes to Grasso. Toward the goal, and Marks right there.
Yeah, courageously came and got that. Looked like Luke Andrews was the Kentucky player pressing there.
Andrews was closing in a hurry and was able to get inside on Diop.
Actually, I think that was Gutman, but nonetheless, good save from George Marks.
So kicking it ahead. Sentio. Nandez.
That's a good ball. Visconti on the counter.
Mason Visconti, the former Tiger. Now a Kentucky Wildcat. Gutman. Screen. Meinzer knocked away. Very aggressive play. Strobuck coming on in the opening half in the later stages and impacting things. Andrews. Maurice now out high and they'll reset. That time, Mines are unable to control. Jorgelson, though, gets it to his teammate. Andrews will now try to run it down. Looks like Maurice initially had a chance on the feed from Jorgelson, and you'll see as we pan to the right, a Kentucky player is down, and I think
that's Meinzer, isn't it?
Marcel Meinzer, the senior out of Germany and one of their team captains.
Yeah, that's not good. Petey appears to be holding his knee.
He is a vital part of what they do. Callum Johnson having a conversation with Isaiah Reed. And getting together right there with Fernandez, but it appears that he simply then twisted the knee. It didn't seem like it was any contact that caused it.
Yeah, perhaps overextended it there. His last touch was a little heavy. He's lunging for it to have a toe poke on it. And he will have to come off the field there, Pete, as the athletic trainer came on for treatment. We'll see if he'll make a return or not.
So Usman Silla and the Clemson Tigers hoping maintain this 1-0 lead as able to walk off under his own strength, but quite gingerly as Marcel Meinzer. That would be an important player for Kentucky not to have available for the remainder of this match.
Looks like Clay Holstead will come in, and I think that's a big loss when you play with a 4-4-2, and that's one of your central midfield players. He's brought a lot of personality to the game. Certainly hope we see him again on the field tonight.
Boy, Meinzer, though, you can tell he's in a lot of pain.
Sometimes, Pete, this cold weather, too, affects that as well.
Holstead out of Birmingham went to Oak Mountain High School. We saw him during the opening half. And now let's see what that could be about. Play stop momentarily. George Marks, Tigers have denied Kentucky any points so far, despite the fact the Wildcats have outshot the Tigers 7-3. As we're under 35 minutes remaining in regulation. Johnson unable to handle the pass.
Good ball in from stepping up. Salvador.
Hoffelner.
Hoffelner's been quick to come off of his line tonight. Really good job of anticipating the through ball there.
Hoffelner trying to be part of what would be a second all-time Elite Eight team for the Wildcats. bounce it away as it was chased down by Andrews initially. Fernandez. And a nice move by Silla. Boy, there's that footwork, Kevin, you referred to earlier. That was just so creative.
Yes, and he's so dangerous as he's running at that last defender.
Asensio, but in the wrong direction.
He demands a lot of attention. Theo Golson so strong on the ball there, Pete.
Wow, that time flying in and doing a nice job to keep it in play. Gudmon. Theo Golson getting it back to screen. There's Rodriguez being dogged by Johnson. And Diop seems to think it should be the Tigers' ball. Or I should say, like Malou that time.
His Clemson numbers are a little tough to.
Yeah, they didn't put them on the back of the jerseys. Very lovely when you get the front view, but a little bit different when the players don't wear numbers. So, Usman Silla, for younger viewers, I mean, you just don't go out on the soccer field and do that. You've got to think that that's hours of work just on the side to get.
Yeah, just so clever technically. He has ideas. He just really difficult to take the ball off of him when he's on the dribble.
Another one of the Tigers from Senegal by way of Montverde Academy in Florida. Strong kick marks. Wind currently not a factor. And a straight kick away by Hoffelner. Strong chase after it for Kentucky Holstad. Battles with Asensio. Silla unable to save it. Well, Bjorgelsen really battling. We noted his coach calls him a handful. He's just so physical at 6'2", 195. And
yeah, Charlie Asensio doesn't even have his boot back on and play has restarted.
Wow. But you see the aggressive play that time, and Asensio never really a chance. I mean, just bodying right up on him was Bjorgelsen.
Yeah, so strong physically. George Marsh going to take his time there and draw Bjorn Golson to him.
Diop.
That's going to be heavy from Asensio. Not a bad idea to release Quinn McNeil. You can see just a one touch here. Just the weight of the pass was too heavy for McNeil to get on the end of.
In midfield, Maurice back to Holstad. Andrews.
You can see that that midfield block for Clemson. The three midfielders just harassing the two center midfielders for Kentucky whenever they're on the ball.
Silla. And the foul against Clemson. Not a bad idea at all. Andrews. It's knocked away.
Yeah, slightly turned Akron there. Akron was able to poke that out for a corner kick. Disciplined defending. Don't commit a foul here.
Oscar Akron, really quick step. But a corner kick upcoming for Kentucky. It'll be their fourth of the night. See the substitution for the Wildcats. From the corner. Strong battle for the ball. Cameron Wheeler just checked in for the Wildcats, but not able to keep it in his team's possession.
Yeah, he gets the last touch there as Diop is just clearing that ball up the line. It's going to be a Clemson throw.
Dangerous place to throw it in.
Substitution for Kentucky. Returning number 8, Marcel Meinzer. And leading the match, number 12, Clay
Holstein. Oh, Meinzer.
Well, that's good news for the Wildcats, as Meinzer, you saw him hopple off earlier, very important midfielder for them. Off the throw-in. Screen.
And then the question, obviously, Peter, will he be the same version of the player that was in the game before? As you said, he was walking gingerly to the sideline after that stoppage.
Kick centered. Good job denying any chance to get the ball for Reed by Grasso. Marks had Andrews closing again, and now we'll get another throw in for the Wildcats.
Yeah, taking no chances there, just pumping that ball away when he's under pressure.
Andrews, first year transfer from St. Mary's in California. Originally from San Jose, so in a different part of the world from which he's accustomed, but a very mobile player. And he's mobile, whereas Bjorgelsen is more of the physical presence. It's really given them a nice combination in their forward group. As you see, Bjorgelsen that time was bumped.
Kentucky was still numbers forward here on the second phase of this corner.
Strong kick across. And Andrews. Tiger throw in here midfield. He couldn't get the angle. Here comes Clemson. I believe that was Meinzer getting back and able to get it back toward midfield. Diop for Clemson. And once again, bodies fly.
Looked like Isaiah Reed actually pulled out of that challenge.
And I believe Marcel Meinzer, the player down again. You see him in the background for Kentucky.
Looked like Reed thought he was going to be late. That was the slightest of touches, if anything.
Might have got an inadvertent kick in the lower shin or ankle area of Meinzer.
Yeah, just a slight touch on the outside of the ankle, which
just looked like a continuation of play.
You know, as crazy as you're right there, there's no connection except that thin sock, Pete. So,
A cold night. Six fouls on Clemson, nine on Kentucky. But keep in mind, the Wildcats had an 8-2 lead in that category at the half. So Clemson's been the team with more infractions here so far in the second half.
I'm not sure what the discussion is. I guess he's telling.
And Isaiah Reed noticeably upset. Reed, the junior out of Rock Hill, played at South Point High.
And I don't know if this is a yellow card offense. In my opinion, you can see he's holding out of the challenge. And if he does make contact, it's the slightest of touches.
So Reed with the yellow card joining Amadi Diop for the Tigers with a yellow card this evening. Screen, the throw-in.
That's a handball.
Amadi Diop that time. Hard contact with Hightower Bjorgelsen.
Now the center official's more concerned with having a conversation with Coach Noonan rather than the handball infraction there.
So let's see what appeared to be an infraction, and yep, whether he meant to or not, Bjorgelsen.
Yeah, gains an advantage by the ball. Fell nicely for him because of that.
Bjorgelsen, Tigers obviously know to get close to him when he's got the ball. Acceleration. Visconti in the battle. And Mason Visconti hitting the deck, staying for him stride for stride. See what kind of aggressive play by Quinn McNeil.
Yeah, just shoulder to shoulder. Was able to hold Visconti off.
Former teammates here at Clemson. Wildcats again sub in. Brandon Parrish for Clemson, we saw him in the opening half of action. You saw Brock Lindau come back on the field for Kentucky, one of their forwards. Not sure if they also brought Daniel Evans, their other forward, back in. But yes, they have. So Bjorgelsen and Andrews getting a rest while Evans and Lindau are now on the pitch for the Wildcats. Sliding kick away by Hoffelman.
And that's a good press by Callum Johnson there, putting the ball in Hoffelman's left foot.
Visconti trying to run it down as Evans. He will. Evans to Rouse. And you see bodies flying in the box. Another foul.
Assistant referee is immediately calling on the.
É, galera, o jogo tá esquentando e esse juizão tá conversando demais. Sempre ele para o relógio, conversa, às vezes não dá nem cartão. Mas lembrando, para quem não conhece muito das regras, que aqui em cima, no cronômetro, quando tem atendimento, quando ele vai conversar, quando ele vai dar amarelo, ele para o relógio. Então, essa cera aí, isso tudo não está gastando tempo. Mas é aquilo, dar uma esfriada sempre, beneficiar do time que está ganhando. Dá aquela esfriada no jogo, vai picando o jogo, aí a gente já passou da metade do segundo tempo e praticamente não aconteceu nada no segundo tempo. Então, ficar cortando o jogo é ruim para quem está querendo correr atrás do resultado.
And to his feet is Diop. He will go off for who knows how long. Head coach walking alongside of him as well. And Diop actually going underneath Lindau. 11 fouls in the match now on the Wildcats, a 6 for the Tigers.
Hello, Matt. You're welcome.
And Diop, very important to the back for the Tigers. We'll see how long it is before he's able to return. Looks like it's going to be almost immediately.
And Diop is on right away. So Justin Malou will slide to right back again.
Wildcats trying to get something going. Casper grinding. Get it back now. Robert Screen. Screen angling it toward Rodriguez. Rodriguez, strong kick ahead, deflected off the body of Lindau. And he goes back to Marks.
Yeah, Marks taking no chances.
Visconti, strong move. Ooh. Dribble around defenders. Centered by Evans. Screen. And ahead for his teammate, but a little bit too strong as he tried to get it to Wheeler.
Substitution for the Tigers. Entering the match, number 9, Mohammed Say.
Mohammed Say, I believe it's his first action of the evening. He's wearing that right knee brace, the junior out of Valencia, Spain. Basically playing with a torn ACL. And they're, as Mike Noonan will tell you, just hoping he can continue on and then he'll deal with the situation after the season.
And Mohammed Say, 5 goals on the year and 2 assists. Petey's so dangerous when the ball is in wide areas, a big body on set pieces. He can give this Clemson attack a little different look than what they have. Very similar to Bjørn Gulson, really.
Say who takes the feed, 6'3". Johnson crossing pass, but easy enough for Hoffelmer.
I think actually Quinn McNeil was trying to nod that down for Fernandez Salvador. That ball's coming in shaped like that and spinning tough to control.
On the attack, grinding. Evans. Boy, it looked like he'd set up grinding right there. Grinding went down, no whistle. Diop, he hits the turf.
Yeah, that looks like a handball.
Wow,
there too,
Lines are some really nice moves. Say. Rodriguez did a very nice job playing the ball and able to set it up for his teammate Wheeler. Johnson for the Tigers.
Yeah, Fernandez Salvador just picked the pocket there with Rouse.
Not a bad idea trying to feed to Johnson. Evans getting it ahead.
See, Pete, I think those are the moments there where Clemson really needs someone like Usman Silla on the ball in that area. He can unlock that Kentucky back line.
Wheeler denied. Denied again with a lefty kick.
Looks like Chifamba's down. He turned awkwardly.
Elton Chifamba out of Blacklick, Ohio, the Clemson freshman. sliding in, trying to defend against Cameron Wheeler, a grad transfer from Louisville for this Kentucky program. So Wheeler moving from one side of the Bluegrass State rival to the other. Chifamba looking like he's able to continue. Lindau was trying to get positioning. Brandon Parrish wasn't able to do anything when the ball got to him. The screen will kick it ahead. Lindau and Evans. Offside.
And Lindau trying to play Evans in. Just looked like Akron just stepped at the last second there to put him in an offside position.
Looked like an opportunity was building for the Wildcats.
So nicely done by Akron. The awareness of knowing just half a step, he's going to be in an offside position.
First time tonight, Wildcats are whistled for the offside. Oscar Agren of the Tigers closing in. It would be another Elite Eight berth for the Tigers, trying to get to an Elite Eight in the NCAA tourney for the 16th time as we're under 20 minutes to play in regulation. Will Callum Johnson's first half goal hold up? Navarro Gomez returns to action. Pass was intended for Say. Chifamba back to Diop. Johnson near the ball for Clemson, but right there for Hoffelder.
Yeah, that actually looks like it was going to kind of shape and stay out of the penalty area, but Hoffelder was able to corral that in.
Screen. Center of the pass for Wheeler. And a foul against Kentucky. Good job around the ball by Elton Chifamba. Looks like he's shaking off that injury from moments ago.
I think he could have gone either way with that call. Looked like there was a lot of tussling from both players.
Johnson, Asensio, Fernandez.
Oof. I tell you, if he's offsides, Pete, it's by the smallest of margins. That was very close.
Show you how close.
Good decision by the assistant referee.
And screen unable to get in the way of a pass across field to him. It just went out as he extended his right leg. Oliver Yule just checked in for the Wildcats. First time we've seen him tonight. And Trey Asensio on the field now for Kentucky, but no relation to Clemson's Charlie Asensio, at least as far as we could tell. On the attack, grinding.
That's a good tackle.
Foot to the ground off the tackle. Oscar Agron there, but the Wildcats now with an opportunity with another corner kick. It'll be their fifth of the night.
Agron just doing a good job of providing cover here.
Cameron Wheeler.
Look at the number of bodies surrounding George Marks. Going to be an in-swinger here.
Reaching from the crowd is Marks.
And he's out of the Tiger Gold. Body easier than it was. Oh, that's got to be a yellow.
Get ready for the crowd to.
That's really surprising it's not a yellow, because in that moment it's a counterattacking opportunity. He's been beaten one-on-one. There's clearly a foul.
Mason Visconti, the former Clemson player, who's been hearing it from the student section there to the right of your screen, and he would have heard it a whole lot more.
Look at this.
Now, you can see the initial contact. As it was Silla hitting the deck.
And these are the moments that Clemson wants to be wary of. When they commit players forward, they can't allow that six, that eight, those holding midfielders to get too far forward and leave them exposed on the counter.
Meinzer.
Now you've got Gomez in there. I think Gomez is Clemson's best holding midfield player. You've got El Chafon, but they both have to be committed to doing the dirty work.
It'll be a throw-in.
Kentucky throwing everyone forward here on this throw-in.
Yeah. A throw-in with some corner kick principles to it. Yule from Denmark heaves it. Header. And kicked away. I believe that was Ogren who was able to get it upfield.
And Clemson can excel.
George Marks was just a face in the crowd as the corner kick came.
Well, first of all, Pete, I love the Tom Petty reference. Yeah, that's more difficult than it is, than it seems there. He's coming out in traffic, trying to take that cross at his highest point.
Attacking the ball. Looked like a wide receiver that time, going up and trying to high point a ball. Now we got Asensio on the grab. I believe that was Asensio and not Gomez. Strong kick, Luca Rodriguez.
Substitution for the Wildcats. Entering the match, number 19, Luke Andrews, and number 21, Nick Gutman.
Luke Andrews and Nick Gutman back on the field, forward and midfielder respectively. And Wildcats obviously needing to get players with more offensive mind out there. I don't know that Bjorgelsen has returned, though, to the field.
Yeah, and you can see they changed their system. They've almost morphed into a back three at moments, committing a lot of players forward. Look at how forward Grosso is. Almost playing with four forwards now, just searching for that equalizer.
Out to get the kick away, and now Yule unable to get it ahead to his teammate Gutman. Amadi Diop for Clemson, and Johnson turned the wrong way. Gutman on the attack for Kentucky.
Clemson's going to have to get some sustained possession here, and Pete, get the ball in wide areas, if you're going to play it in behind that Clemson back or that Kentucky back line, get the ball in wide areas.
Contact down low. Grasso, top of the box centering. Yule. Still a nice job. Say, though, unable to do much with it.
You need pressure on this ball.
Luke Andrews hitting the deck. Actually, that time it was Bailey Rouse. Sensio for Kentucky. Oh, nice feed. Gutman with Diop closing in a hurry. Yule. And who dangerous play.
Nervous moments there.
And the body language by Justin Malou, I think, tells it all. For a second, it's almost as if George Marsh's goalkeeper froze and is thinking, what are you doing?
Yeah, he can't. He has to make a play on that because he's got, looked like Grinning was coming in at the back post. You can see he pulled out of it.
Corner for Kentucky.
Looks like Akron there.
Yep, Akron able to boot it away at 6'3". He's a physical presence, obviously, for Clemson.
And obviously, Yule coming in will be another long throw they'll have to contend against.
Yule, one of the many from a Scandinavian nation on this Kentucky team. Strong kick by Meinzer, but Grasso unable to contain it. So less than 15 minutes in is when we got the lone tally of this match. There was a foul and allowed the Tigers to restart. And what a nice setup for Callum Johnson.
Yeah, first touch preparing the ball here. Just the slightest of deflections. Throws Hoffenauer off. And that's how we got here, Pete.
Guzman Silla, Oscar Agrin assisting. The third goal of the season for the Boston College transfer, Callum Johnson out of New York City. He wants to see his 2021 season continue for his Clemson team.
And I think that's a good tactical substitution from Mike Noonan there, pulling on Isaiah Reed for Muhammad Sey. This game was just not for Sey what he does, but it's opened up to the extent if they can get Reed in behind with his pace, he can cause some trouble. This is going to be a counterattacking opportunity here.
Callum Johnson battling. Silla unable to do anything with it for Clemson. And that's well beyond the opportunity for Gutman to catch up to it for Kentucky. Second all-time meeting, both times in NCAA tourney play. A 3-overtime, 1-0 Clemson win back in November of 2001 in the first meeting. So Bjorgelsen, among their top offensive threats, back on the field as the stretch run has arrived for the Wildcats.
And Clemson will use all of these stoppages to milk all of the time off the clock that they can.
Diop falling down off the kick. Yule.
Play advantage there.
Able to get it ahead to his teammate, Grinning. Now Bjorgelsen.
Job number one, deny the cross.
Malou right there defending and denying that, as you said, the crossing pass.
Oh, he's going to come back and he's going to issue Guzman Silla booking. That's why he stopped the clock. Just off the video view there. allowed advantage to play on it.
Well, the first year transfers
for Johan Cedergren's team. Como eu falei, o gol foi do outro lado da zaga, porque o lado direito dele da zaga
both in the back, but also in moments like that.
Provavelmente é o melhor brasileiro na NCAA jogando na zaga.
The kind of tight match we anticipated coming in.
Tá no script, 1-1, se continuar empatado, vai pro overtime. Overtime é gol de ouro. E, enfim, nada acabou ainda, vamos lembrar até um pouco o jogo da Libertadores de ontem. Deixar destaque aqui para o Rômulo, que o Rômulo jogou com o Luca. Pode ter me corrigido, Rômulo, na liga semiprofissional que eles estavam jogando, na NPSL. E aí o Luca transferiu da Oral Roberts para Kentucky e acabou que o Rômulo foi para a Oral Roberts jogar na vaga do Luca. Então, já jogaram juntos e um já jogou até na vaga do outro. O técnico de Kentucky. Mas é isso, vamos voltar para a transmissão, 1-1. Faltando aí 4 minutos de jogo. Se for para o overtime, a gente comenta mais sobre o que vai acontecer nesse overtime. Mas golaço, parabéns aí para o Luca, para a família. É isso, tá cheio de torcedor aqui de Clemson assistindo, mas
third yellow card on the night against the Wildcats. So an opportunity for the Tigers. Pipe Fernandez Salvador. The perspective of Hoffman, the goalkeeper, off to his right. Strong kick. And an opportunity for the Tigers out front. I believe Malou, but unable to capitalize. Wildcats back on the attack. Mason Visconti, centering pass. Diop, now grinding. Told you he's an emerging player in their program, and the fact that he's out there at this stage of the game, a freshman from Denmark, important for them. Martin's able to reach down and stop that from causing any damage, and a little bit of disbelief expressed by Luke Andrews that there was no foul call.
Yeah, he's looking for a penalty there, isn't he?
And the foul against Clemson. Marcel Meinzer standing over the ball. Justin Malou on that last foul. Kentucky 14 fouls in the match. That was the eighth against the Tigers. Meinzer, the native of Germany, strong kick. Right of the goal, Marks able to deny the header. And slow to get up, Bailey Rouse, the senior out of Littleton, Colorado.
Yeah, it looked like Diop just undercut him there, didn't it? Little flick onto the back post. I think Diop's fortunate he isn't.
I thought Diop was made, but it looked like he was just trying to play the ball, but I mean, that's the kind of contact. And now help to his feet is Rouse, another one of their team captains. They really relied on the leadership of Meinzer, a senior, and Rouse. Mark saw Kentucky tie it on the header by Rodriguez just moments ago for his fifth goal of the year. Fourth player for Kentucky with 5 goals on the season, Rodriguez, who transferred from Oral Roberts for this season. Trying to run it down, Andrews. Some contact, play continues.
Here comes a foul. Quick on the counter.
Silla was expecting a whistle. Hamidi Diop.
Yeah, Pete, credit to Kentucky. They put Luis Grosso up front looking for the equalizer, and he's been so dangerous they've elected him keep him there.
You just saw his leaping ability. Well, give and go try, but defended nicely by the Tigers. And play stopped momentarily, I believe. Ogren might have taken a kick.
No, I think he sees a little bit of blood on.
And then also
Asensio.
Asensio with some blood. But back near the goal area, it looked like Ogren was trying to shake off a little bit of contact. And now he's, you see, walking toward midfield. Well, things get cleared up with Asensio. Senior out of Roswell, Georgia. Asensio, much to his surprise, has to wait on the sidelines. In traffic, Mainzer. Gutmann getting it ahead. Offsides against Kentucky. Asensio checks back in for Clemson. Their fine goalkeeper, Jan Hofelner, came in
having given up 6 in 17 matches.
He gives up 2 in match number 18.
Do volante, o cara que veio de trás, o Luca encostou no atacante, a linha de ataque estava toda marcada, mas o cara que veio de trás, ele não tem como acompanhar, se o volante não vier correndo.
You can see the anguish in the face of Johan
Cedergren,
the head coach
of
the Wildcats. Kentucky with not a lot of time to try to answer. Under a minute to play in regulation. Fernandez will let it go. And you notice he kicked it away to try to make it more difficult for order to be restored. So the clock stops, 51 seconds to go.
And you just know the referee is going to stop the clock on any situation like that.
Another throw in by Yule.
Well, it'd only be fitting that you would have to defend a few of these here down the stretch after getting that go-ahead goal.
Another throw in. Very strong.
I think that's a goal kick. Oh, it's going to be a corner.
And it's going to be a corner kick.
All hands on deck for Clemson here. And you can see everyone coming forward.
Seventh of the night, we will see.
Even Elner's in there as well.
Alan Johnson got the scoring going inside of the first 15 minutes. And it was Alvaro Gomez who snapped a one-all tie in the closing minutes of half number two. Tigers improved to 15-5 on the season. The Wildcats campaign comes to an end with just their second loss. Kentucky 15-2-4 to close it out in the fall of 2021.
Well, that's a tough way to go out, losing in the last minute to play there, but after the win over Denver in the second round of the tournament, Coach Newman reflected on the fight he felt his team had.
The teams combined for 22 fouls and 5 yellow cards. So it was a physical match. At times, it was chippy. The scoring began in the opening half. A little over 13 minutes in, Callum Johnson coming through with his third goal of the season. After effects, Alvaro Gomez set up by Justin Malou.
Yeah, his first touch there from Gomez outside of the boot. Not only controls the ball, but puts it beyond the two defenders. And just a little deke over the keeper's outstretched legs.
Less than a minute 10 to go when the winning goal was delivered by Gomez. There's Callum Johnson, the Boston College transfer, who sees his season and the Tigers extended. So Clemson moves on to the Elite Eight, the quarterfinal round, getting ready
to find out who wins on the other side of the bracket. They're just underway out in Corvallis, Oregon. The number one seed, Oregon State Beavers, taking on the number 16 seed, New Hampshire Wildcats. We expected a tight match, Kevin. That's what we got tonight.
Oh, absolutely. I thought it was a terrific befitting of a Sweet 16 game here, and I think everyone here in Tigertown will be rooting for New Hampshire tonight, because that would mean they'd host an Elite Eight game on the weekend.
Tigers do know they're moving on to the Elite Eight with another win on the season to give them 15. They'll find out within the next couple of hours who they play and where next weekend. Our final tonight, Clemson 2, Kentucky 1. For Kevin Kennedy.
É isso, galera. Golzinho no final, sofrido ali. A gente estava achando que a gente ia levar para o overtime, enfim, achar um gol, ir para os pênaltis, como foi a história da Marshall, mas esse gol acabou com todos os planos. Mas, de novo, temporada absurda do Luca. Até conversei com ele semanas atrás para ver os próximos passos deles, então tomara que dê tudo certo para ele na caminhada. Ele tem mais uma temporada para jogar com o Kentucky. Mandar um abraço aí para o Marcos, para a Simone, o pessoal da família do Luca também. Lembrando agora que brasileiros nos Nationals, a gente ainda tem o Rodrigo e o Guilherme na pitch. Pittsburgh vai jogar contra Notre Dame na próxima rodada, jogaço, a gente vai transmitir. E ainda tem o Bernardo de New Hampshire, que ainda vai jogar nas oitavas agora à noite, um pouco mais tarde o jogo. Se eles passarem, a gente tem duas equipes com brasileiros. Vamos tentar continuar acompanhando. Pitt vem muito forte para o título, as minhas apostas eram realmente Pitt e Kentucky. Kentucky acabou ficando pelo caminho, mas Pitt ainda segue. Já tá tarde, vou desligar aqui para arrumar tudo. Valeu, galera. Boa noite para todo mundo. Boa noite, Marco, Simone. E valeu. Vou finalizar por aqui.